Yes, hello at the Crossroads Church Connect Group. So good to be with you again. Today we are continuing our study on discerning of spirits. This is lesson five on the gifts of the Holy Spirit. So we're talking about discerning of spirits. Just a quick recap. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 to 11. We're recapping this every week because I want to get it in your spirit so that if people ask you what the nine gifts of the Spirit is, you'll be able to tell them. It says, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith through the same Spirit, to another gifts of healings by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different types of tongues, to another interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all things, distributing to each individually as He wills, as God wills. And so here's the overview of the nine gifts of the Spirit. The first group of the gifts of the Spirit is the utterance gifts. So the utterance gifts is the tongues, the interpretation of tongues, and prophecy. These are utterance gifts, and they're to be spoken out. They're gifts of the Holy Spirit. The second is the gifts of revelation, which is your word of knowledge, your word of wisdom, and your discerning of spirits. And the third group is the power gifts. So we have the gift of faith, the gift of healings, and the gift of the working of miracles. Okay? So one thing we need to understand, first and foremost, when it comes to discernment, the best tool to discern is the word of God. We need the word of God. That's final authority. And that's how we discern. We discern with the word. We see in 1 John chapter 4, verse 1 to 3, John is telling us, beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God, and every spirit that does not believe or confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and now already is in the world. And so we understand that any spiritual system, any religious system that doesn't confess Jesus Christ as God coming in the flesh to redeem mankind, it's not of God. It's the spirit of Antichrist, okay? So we need to test the spirits. Very important that we learn to test the spirit. And many people don't because they're afraid of quenching the Holy Spirit. Listen, if you're afraid of quenching the Holy Spirit, live an upright life. Live with honesty and integrity and character, because sin quenches the Spirit more than testing what's happening in an atmosphere. And so I want to say this: one third of Jesus' ministry was deliverance from evil spirits. And we see Jesus going about and he would heal the sick. And sometimes when he's praying for the sick, he would cast out a spirit of infirmity, okay? The New Testament mentions demons 80 times. And so we need to ask God for discernment. God wants his people to discern whether or not there is a spirit at work. The actual word discern means to see. That's all it means. It means to be able to see. God wants to, by his Holy Spirit, allow you to see and understand what's going on in the realm of the spirit. So the discerning of spirits is the God-given ability to detect the presence and the identity of spirits. Okay? So a spirit is a living personality, and that's what we want to discuss today. There's three areas to discern in the gift of discerning of spirits. The first one is the Spirit of God. We need to discern, is this the Spirit of God speaking to me? Is this the Spirit of God working through an individual? Or number two, is it the human spirit? We're able to discern the human spirit versus the Holy Spirit. Sometimes there's a need to discern, even as a pastor, if somebody's coming in, if they have good intentions. They can say all the right things. They can have a smile on their face. They can lift their hands during worship. But sometimes there's a discernment that comes to a pastor that there's something off in that spirit. And I've had that situation in times past. Many years ago, we had a situation where somebody came in and they just fit the cookie cutter for a Christian. And everybody thought this person was so great. But what ended up happening was that person, I knew in my spirit, there's something off. There's something off. There's something I can't, I'm discerning something's not good. And sure enough, this person shifted, and there was issues. And so there's a discerning of the human spirit. You need to have the gift of discerning, even with your children and the friends you hang out with and those kind of things. And thirdly is to discern evil spirits. So we discern the spirit of God. We discern human spirits, whether or not people have a good spirit, or we also discern evil spirits. And so it's important here to understand here that there's three levels of devils. Say three levels of devils. My goodness. We want to talk about that in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. So there are different levels of devils. That seems very clear in the scripture that there's a hierarchy in the system of the demonic. And I want to look at Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 to 13. It says here, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you'll be able to stand against, you'll be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand." Now, I want you to see here, we have some different categories. So the first one is the rulers of darkness. These are the highest class of evil spirits. Okay, this is what we understand from scripture. These spirits will rule where the gospel has not been preached. So when you think of darkness, where there's darkness, there is no light. So wherever there's the gospel's not gone, these rulers of darkness have the stronghold in those areas, okay? So wherever the gospel has not shone over a country, wherever the gospel light has not shone in the lives of people, there's rulers of darkness there. The next group is the powers, and they actually rule over principalities. Principalities seem to be the lowest form of demonic spirits. So principalities come from the word principles, which is your beliefs, your behavior, your chain of reasoning, okay? And so your beliefs, your behaviors, and your thought life, that's where the principalities come in and will come in and affect you. And this many times will open the door for sickness in your life. We address spiritual warfare at a principality level when you come through our highway to wholeness. You know, how to take every thought captive. Those are principles. Those are spirits that bring, you know, beliefs and behaviors and thought patterns into your life. And so we understand that people can be demonized, which means they're possessed by a spirit or spirits in their spirit, in their soul, and in their body. Now, when you become a believer, old things pass away. Behold, all things become new. The Bible says the gospel, you know, comes and the spirit comes and he lives inside of you. So your spirit is saved. So suddenly you're possessed in your spirit by the Holy Spirit. Say hallelujahs. That's good news. All right. And we see that in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. But the enemy can still torment our soul. He can still torment our body with sickness. Okay. Unless we make a conscious decision to do something. In Romans chapter 12, verse 1 to 2, this is what we're commanded to do, okay? We're going to read it together. And so Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2 says, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you present yourself a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service." And so Paul is saying, I beseech you, present your bodies a living sacrifice. And verse 2 says, "And be not conformed to the world, but be transformed," how? "By the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and the perfect will of God." And so, as believers, if we don't offer our body and our soul to the Lord as a sacrifice, "Lord, this is yours. I give you my thought life. I give you my physical body." And then if you don't allow yourself to be transformed by the renewing of your mind, there's a possibility that as a Christian even, you can have demons tormenting your thought life, demons coming and tormenting your emotional life, okay? You can have spirits of fear, envy, self-pity, accusation, hate, depression. You can have an unloving spirit. You can have an occult spirit if you're dabbling with occultism, okay? And many of these spirits will open up the door for a spirit of infirmity to come in and affect your body. And so how many know it's important that we have a discerning of spirit so that we can drive devils far from us, far from our loved ones, so we can live the life of victory, okay? So all revelation comes through either vision, dreams, okay, or just an inner knowing, a peace. The Bible says we're led by the peace of God. When you don't have a peace in your heart, then you can pray into it, and then God will give you sometimes thoughts, and you'll know, okay, this I'm discerning something here, and then you can pray into it, and God will reveal it to you. Then we also have spiritual senses. Just like you have natural senses, you can see, you can hear, you can touch, you can feel, you can smell, you can taste, these five natural senses. We also have spiritual senses in the realm of the spirit, where we can have experiences where God will allow us to hear or see or feel or smell something in the spirit that is kind of like a door opening, all right? Because I dabbled in the occult when I was younger, when I get around someone who is dabbling with the occult, I can feel and sense that spirit, and I can say to them, hey, are you dabbling in the occult? And they're usually like, wow, how did you know? It's because I can sense it. I can feel it. You cannot teach this stuff. You have to experience it. You have to learn it as you walk in relationship with God. I found that religious spirits have a stuffy, musty smell. Sometimes when I'm praying for someone, I can smell that coming off of them, and it's like it comes from the inside, and you're like, ugh, and you just know it's a religious spirit. Sexual spirits have a very foul, septic smell and you don't smell it with your natural smell. You smell it, it's hard to explain. You can smell it. It's an internal spiritual smell. Very weird to explain, but it's there. And so sometimes God gives us a picture of a certain animal to show us a characteristic of a certain spirit. You might have a snake slithering, which would really represent, you know, deception. It would represent, a Leviathan type of spirit. As you exercise your spiritual senses, you learn to discern. And that's the most important thing. When David talks about tasting and seeing that the Lord is good, when we hear, you know, the fragrance of the Lord, we see all of these analogies to the senses in the scripture. This isn't just metaphoric. There's actually, you're able to, as a spirit being, you're able to, as you exercise your spiritual senses, you can pick up on these things when the Holy Spirit allows it. It's not something you pursue or seek after, but it's something that the Lord allows. Sometimes in an amazing worship service, there's a sense and just a scent of an aroma of, just an aroma of incense or roses or whatever. And you can smell, and it's like, where did that come from? And that is just a discerning of the Holy Spirit, a discerning of the Lord. And so these are levels that you never chase them. You don't go after them. You don't seek for them. But as you grow in the Lord and you have opportunities to minister to people, you need to trust God to give you discerning of spirits and say, Lord, I'm open to this thing, and I want you to use me in this. So today I'm going to give you some passages to read, and there's not going to be questions and answers. Just really, I want it to be a time of discussion. So number one, Jesus discerns the human spirit. We see this in John chapter 1. Verse 43 and 51. So if you can read that together, have some discussion about that. Obviously, Nathanael was known for his honesty and his character, because he was so shocked that Jesus kind of discerned his spirit and who he was as a person. Then Paul discerns an evil spirit in Acts chapter 16, verse 16 to 19, if you want to read that just have a discussion about that. What that looks like, and maybe you've had experience in your own life in discerning of spirits. You can have a time of discussion and openness about that, all right? And I want you to also, just if you have extra time, look at Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 9 to 14. It talks about how does God feel about divination, because that's really opens the door for all kinds of problems in the realm of the spirit, okay? So I want you guys to study that, have a great discussion about it, and then have a time of prayer and ask God to sharpen your discernment and to allow the gift of discernment to operate in your life. Have a great week and have a great time of prayer and discussion. God bless.